Hey, three people watching. Hello. Let me just post this here and there. That should work. Two people viewing. Hello, people. Good evening. Good evening. Good evening. Good evening, people. So, today we got a little bit of a surprise stream, unannounced. What my plan is today is to make some ornaments for the map that we've been making, but also to create some Photoshop brushes. I want to show you some new stuff and just go into detail on how to create your Photoshop brushes. So, I'm excited. Let's get started. First things first. We're gonna make a new Photoshop document because that's what we need, and we're gonna make sure that it's high enough resolution. So I'm going for print size pixels per inch, which is usually like 300 pixels per inch, where screen size is 72 pixels per inch. But we want to make sure that the stuff that we make is available for print, and then we're going to, let's say, 4000 or 5000 in size. And I'm gonna make an area where we can play around making our brushes. So this one can go. This will be our playing area for the brushes. And to make a cool playing area, we wanna add some settings. So to be able to see what we're doing, let's give it a little bit of a green background. A little less saturated, something that might look like the background of, or like a real map, colored map, and then we're gonna set up a bevel and emboss so that we can play around with our height map settings. Now what we're going to do is, if you draw with your pen a certain shape, and you go to blending options, right click your layer, blending options, and you select the bevel and emboss, and let's make it white and black. You can see that it kind of pops out. Let's put this on 45, that's my favorite setting, and it wanted to go up. You can see that it kind of pops out from the screen, yeah? That's what we want, because we want to make height map brushes. But we don't necessarily want to see the color that our brush is putting down. So let me show you when I get somewhere to my height map brushes. If I draw my height map brush, I get my mountains, but I don't necessarily want to see the black color that I'm painting. And what I could do is paint with the green to get that same effect. But what I rather do is go to blending options and put fill opacity all the way to 0%. Now what that does is, let me show you. If I paint with black or white or any other color, it doesn't show the actual color that I'm painting with, the red or anything like that. So that's what we want. And when I change my blending options to add the fill opacity, you can see it shows the color, but we don't necessarily want it. So fill opacity is 0. Another thing that I like to do is I like to work in a layer mask instead of the layer itself. Because if I draw in here and I want to erase some of the mountains, I get a different brush and different brush settings than the one from my paintbrush. So I could set up a eraser that I like with the same effects as the paintbrush. But what happens if we fill this layer with any color, let's say black, is, and we add a layer mask, let's go here, and we fill it with black to make it empty. Now we can paint with this brush to add, if I use the white color, and to remove if I use the black color. I press X to change the colors. And that gives me much more of a natural flow in creating these hills and mountain brushes or any texture brushes. What it would look like with fill opacity on is like this. And let's just to be clear, show you what it does with just normal selections. So everything that's white is being shown in the layer mask over here. And if I take a normal round brush and I paint in with black in this layer, it shows what is underneath, yeah? Or the other way around. Let's make sure the background layer is black. If I paint in with white, it shows the actual contents of the layer. So that's what I use to when I'm using my brushes. I hope that's clear. Hey Ross, welcome. Ross Strobich says, I love what the brush is able to do. I'm going to have to go back and watch the previous videos in this series. Well, thank you, man. Yeah, sure. Watch it when you have time. Today we're playing around with making our own brushes. But this is basically the settings that I use to make my work on my textures. It's important that you know what I'm doing. So this is basically what I'm doing with my height map brush. When Befell and a boss is not on, you can see what's happening, yeah? But when I turn it on and I remove my fill opacity, you can see that it kind of becomes like a mountainous terrain. Now, color wise, because we're working with green, I want to add a little bit of a lighter color as my highlight, maybe something like this, not exactly white, and maybe a bit more of a dark muddy as my shadows. But let's make sure that it's properly dark. Something like this seems to work, and we can also reduce a little bit of the highlight, maybe something like this to make it pop more. And what we could do is we could increase the size to make the texture come out a little bit more. Something like this looks pretty good. to get started with our making our height map brushes. So this will be our playground. Let me save it, just so we know. Playground. So Ross says, I do 3D animation and can see using this to create my own world maps for planets. Yeah, exactly. There's even a friend of mine called Avant Novis who imports his height maps from his worlds into ZBrush to create 3D worlds. And he's currently working on something where you can actually, go into those terrains and worlds. So make sure to check him out as well. So this is our playground area. So you guys know what's going on. Now, what I usually did to make my brushes was go to a website called Tangram's Height Mapper. You can just type in Tangram Height Mapper in Google. And then you go to this website, which shows height maps of the Earth. What I used to do is go to an area that's just interesting to me, shape-wise. Something that's not too long, something that's a little bit circular or squarish, not too stretched out. For example, this area over here looks quite interesting to me. And you can just scroll around like you are using Google Maps. What this software does is it creates the shades automatically if you put on auto exposure, which means that it will try to figure out what's the highest point in your current screen and what's the lowest point in your current screen. Your highest point will be the white and your lowest point will be the black. And when you zoom in, you'll see that some parts will become brighter because the lowest and the highest points will change around. To make our own brushes, it is a little bit easier if we're able to have control over what should be the highest point and what should be the lowest point, because we deal with the following. So let me show you in Photoshop after I selected this. Let's play around with this a little bit. We want to make sure that we've got some pure black background. And then we want to make sure that we've got some more highlights in the brush. Something like this looks pretty good. So what I would do is I would press print screen on my keyboard. There we go. Go into Photoshop, new. And create and paste it in. Now we don't need the browser stuff, so we'll just make a selection of the area that we are trying to work with, which is this. I press Ctrl copy, Ctrl Shift V to paste in place, and the lower layer can go. So when making a brush, let's go into a little bit of detail in what happens when you make a brush. In Photoshop, the blacks is where the paints are going to be applied and the whites is going to be transparent. So let's say if we go with a round brush and we draw a smiley face. Wow, this is the ugliest smiley face in the world. All right, let's use the pen for this. Yeah, and we drag a selection around it. We can say define brush presets, and as you can see it takes the contents of my square and create a brush out of it. So now I can just use this as a brush everywhere, but we don't want that. What I want to show you is let's say we have an area with shades of gray. And we paint in some white here and there. Let's go like this. And we drag a selection around this. And we say define brush preset. You'll see that when I take another color, the areas that were gray and black are the areas that contain the paint, and the areas that are white do not contain the paint. So that's it. That's how you create brushes in Photoshop, and that's how the brushes work with the darks and the lights. So to make this brush into a proper height map brush, what we need to do is we need to flip around, inverse the image, Control I, to show that we get so that we get the blacks instead of the whites background. Let's grab a soft round brush to clean up the area a little bit, because here you see a little bit of a hard edge. We don't want it, so let's get our whites in and just paint in here. And I'm also not a fan of the random dots that are scattered around this area. So this could be a quite interesting brush, yeah? So this thing should already be finished for creating our own Photoshop brush. How we do is we make a selection around it and we say define brush preset. And let's give it a name, because you always should name stuff. I always forget and it becomes a huge mess. So stream test. Now what we can do with this brush is just drop it in like this. But yeah, it's nice because we can. I'll show you in the playground. If I paint this in, you can see that we get some quite interesting height heights already, but the brush isn't perfect just yet, because if I drag around this brush, it doesn't look so nice because it's repetitive. There's not much difference in the spacing and things like that. And luckily this is some stuff that we can tweak. So how do we tweak this? We go to this little icon over here, brush properties. And here, for example, we can say, let's increase the spacing a little bit. Now when I draw in, it will be a bit more spaced around as such, but because it's all in the same direction, it still looks very repetitive. So what we can do is we can play around with some more settings. One of the settings that I always turn on for my height map brushes is the shape dynamics. So we select the shape dynamics, make sure that it's turned on. And then we can say, I want the size to jitter. And what happens then is sometimes it will make a large version of the brush, and sometimes it will make a small version of the brush. I don't really use that often, because I like to use pen pressure for that. Because I'm using a Wacom tablet, I can say the control for the size is done with pen pressure. And now if I draw in and I, with my pen, I push really softly here, it will bring in a small dot. When I push medium, it will make a medium dot. If I push heavily, well, it will become big. Yeah. So I can go from a soft stroke to a more thick stroke and increase the height of my or the size of my brush. If you don't have a Wacom tablet and you're just using a mouse, you can say controls off and have it randomly add a size, use a size jitter. So for me, because I'm using Wacom tablet, I'm using pen pressure. What I do like to turn on is the angle jitter, which means that with each dot it places down, it rotates the dot a little bit. It rotates the version of the brush a little bit, which already shows that it's a lot less repetitive, yeah? And now, especially because we are working in this layer, we can switch around the black and the white to add and the black to subtract. So I press X, black will become my foreground color, and I can remove some of this white and it will add some of this. and let's zoom in to 100%. And you can already see that we get some pretty cool hide effects on our map. What else can we play around with? Let's save this brush again. So we go here and we say, because this, the previous brush that we made didn't have these settings that we currently edit, and now it will. So let's say stream test 2. You will see that the effect is also visible in the brush preview, and streams test 1 can go away because we already made a better version of the same brush. Let's go for a little bit of a different kind of brush that you can use for map making. I want a little bit of a random business. Hey, Avanovis. There he is. Good evening. How are you today? So this stream was unannounced, and it was just a little bit of extra because my D&D session didn't go through tonight. Someone was really tired, which is okay, which means that I have more time to work on this kind of stuff. What I want to work on is I want to have some interesting shapes that I will have able to scatter. So this I like. Let's go with this. So this will be my base, and then I will add some more shapes. Let's go with maybe soft round. We'll add some shapes. Just remove some and add some. Add some different sizes as well. And I'm gonna get my smudge tool to make sure that those things aren't perfectly round, because we don't want perfectly round. Perfectly round doesn't often show itself in the real world. Good to hear that you're doing good, man. Yeah, so we're just playing around making some brushes today, and later some ornaments for the map. What I'm showing is now the different type of brushes that you can make and use, and the effects that you can create on your brushes. So let's grab this guy. Define brush preset, stream test 3. And now when I paint, it will show this. This is not what we want. We want to play around with some more settings. So I showed you before that we can increase the spacing to make the thing a little bit more random. And let me turn off the sound of my phone real quick. I always forget. And I showed you shape dynamics with pen pressure on and angle jitter on, which I like. So now you get this effect. But we want to play around with some more stuff. I'm going to make this brush a much smaller brush. So I'm going for like 200 pixels. And I'm going to play around with scattering. What scattering does, it creates multiple versions of your brush if you increase the count, like this. So let's say count 4. And it places them in an off position, like this. So it offsets the position of the brush. So now this looks quite good. And you can also say go both ways, not just up and down, but both ways, like this. So now it's jittered and scattered around. We can go crazy by saying let's do 16 variations and make them scatter real quick, and then one click will create something like this, which is a bit too crazy and uncontrollable for me. But that's what scatter does. And the count jitter says sometimes you add a lot of them and sometimes not a lot. And you can control again those things with pen pressure, for example. So this is quite interesting. Let's go to our playground map and see what it does. Painting with white. It's more like speckles. Little specks of texture that we're adding. Yeah, doesn't look too bad. So that's what scattering does. So we create stream test 4. It's the same as stream test 3, but it just adds this scatter functionality to it. So stream test 3 can go. Bloop. Avanova says, thank you for your help yesterday. Yeah, no problem. I saw your Badlands map. It looked so amazing, really nice. I can also show you maybe a bit better what scattering does, just to make sure that you guys get it, by using a hard round brush. Yeah, so let's get rid of this. Let's create a smaller version of the scattering. So now when I paint, you'll see just a line, but if I turn on scatter and also spacing a bit more and the count jitter, you can see it will just add these random dots everywhere. Blah, 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 blah. Yeah, so that's pretty cool. So let's turn scattering off for now. Next thing that I want to show you is transfer, because that's that one is a little bit easier than the rest, and we're going to ease into it. Transfer, you know, when you're painting with Photoshop, you can go 100% opacity, 50% opacity, and make it cover with the paint a bit less. You can also say that your brush has opacity jitter, so some of the dots will be very visible and some of them won't. Like this. You can also say, I want my pen pressure to tell Photoshop how much visibility you have. So now I'm pressing really soft. Now I'm pressing harder and harder and harder and harder and harder and softer again. So that's how you can play around with the opacity of this brush. It's something that I use for some of my brushes, not all of them. Now we're going to an interesting one, which is texture. Texture can make your brush from pretty simple to very crazy. What it does, the same goes for dual brush. It takes information from something else, in this case, a texture pattern that you've made, or in the case of dual brush, another brush that you made, and it somehow makes it interfere with the brush that you're currently using. So in Photoshop you have this standard spongy texture, and I see, if you change the mode, you can get some really weird effects. Let's see. So now when I draw, a little bit of the spongy texture will show through each time. This can be good if you want to have some canvas, if you want to have the feel that you're drawing on a canvas or such. And you can play around with these blending modes and these settings, because Photoshop has so many sliders and settings that it's almost impossible to, you can kind of guess what it's gonna do if you're becoming good at Photoshop, but it's almost impossible to really imagine completely what the changing the slider will do. So what I do a lot of times, I will just play around with it, mess around with it until I have something that works. And the more I mess around with it, the more clear it becomes for other, for making other brushes for what it's actually doing. So this is the texture. Dual brush. Yeah, Ross, I'm gonna sub to you as well. Let's see. I'm gonna do it on my other computer though. Ross, let's see. What do you make? Channel. I can't find you. Why not? There we go. So we've got a guy in chat who makes 3D stuff. Oh, that's super cool. That's Star Trek. I see a lot of Star Trek models. And explosions and such. Awesome. So if you guys are into 3D stuff and science fiction stuff, make sure to check out Russ Throwbridge channel. All right, dual brush. So this is interesting because it makes your brush a little bit more random. So let's say we chose our first brush tip shape, which is this dot. Yeah. And then in dual brush, we can select another brush shape. So let's select one of the brushes that we've made. I want to see the names if possible. Because I'd like to use the brushes that I've made in this session. Yeah, stream test. So we're gonna take stream test and we're gonna play around with what it does. So again, the blending mode really makes a lot of difference of what you're doing. And now when I draw with the circle, it kind of takes some information from the other brush and combines it with the current brush, as you can see. So that can give a really nice random effect to your brush. Of course, we don't want to use this with a round brush, so let's find a new cool shape to work with. We're going to our 10 gram earth mapper, make sure auto exposure is on for the searching, and we're going to find a new cool shape that we can work it and work with and combine with another shape, another brush. So let's see, what's this? This is kind of interesting. Let's play around with the exposure. Some candy is also important. All right, let's print screen this. So as before, we need to cut out the shape from our backgrounds. Invert the layer so our background is white. Clean up some of these little dots over here. Oh, not with the clone tool, but with the brush. Oh, this, I was seeing this black dot and I wanted to get rid of it, but it was just mess on my screen. Okay. So this should look good. Make a selection around it. Say define brush preset. So let's see at what it does. We want to add some spacing and size jitter, space jitter to it. Some size bend pressure and some angle jitter to it. Spacing like this. Okay, let's get rid of this. And let's see in our playground map. We get this sort of flat hilltop hill mountain type. And then if we reduce it with changing the color back to white, we get this pretty cool mountain shapes already from the get-go. So this is a good brush. I have a good feeling about this brush already, because look at this cool shapes. Let's check the chat for a second, because we've got a troll in the chat. Josh Troll asks, hello, do you play video games? Yes, I do, but not that much anymore, because it takes a lot of time. Currently, I start another new game of modded Minecraft, Sky Factory. It just relaxes me a lot. Let's make a new brush out of this with this settings, just to make sure that we've got it. And now we want to play around with the dual brush. So we're going to change the blend mode. Oh, first we need to select a brush. So let's select our stream brush and play around with the blending modes. This might actually be pretty interesting. Let's see. Let's clear the canvas and let's see what this does. So it makes the brush a lot smaller, but we can play around when we change the spacing or the scatter or the count. Let's see. So dual brush is interesting if you've got a brush that has that looks too repetitive, because you can mix it with another brush and it will create a cool effect like this. Yeah. Quite happy with this brush, but I think I might like the version that we made earlier without the dual brush better. But I'm just showing what the abilities are when creating new brushes, because what I like to do, even if it looks like really weird and messy like this, if I go in with my other brush, I can just chop little pieces out of the paint that I already applied to create this interesting shapes. Gives me a bit more control. And especially when I'm using my pen, because now I was using my mouse, I can put really tiny dots or really big dots to create interesting shapes in my area. So yeah, this makes me really happy, this brush. Now I want to go into something a bit more advanced in a second, something that I recently figured out. Let's see the chat. Slim Shady Boy asks, where are you from? I'm from the Netherlands, Holland, the lowlands. Before I go into that little bit more advanced stuff of what I found out just yesterday, which I'm really, really happy with, I want to show you something else. So let's just make sure that we get some interesting shapes in here. And then I will show you how to use the layer blending mode to create different effects. So you can use this on multiple layers. You can say, I want to have one layer with the texture looking such, and one layer with the texture looking so. So let's go in here like this. And I want to go to my bevel and a boss in the blending layer. So what you can do here is a couple of things. One thing you can do is you can change the layer style, which I don't recommend. I recommend using the inner bevel, because the outer bevel just makes the bevel go outside of the paint. And to me, it works with less control, but whatever floats your boat. Emboss, similar. Pillow emboss makes it go up and down. Oh, look at this. What? This is actually a pretty cool effect. Wow. I might use this some other time, but it might become clearer what it actually does if I use a hard round brush for now. Or soft round, let's go with soft round. So, pillow emboss goes up and down. So it's like a little indent where it goes a bit lower and then it goes up again. It has its uses, especially if you're making surfaces on metal and things like that. Stroke emboss, I think, works together with the stroke function. So you've got emboss, which takes the outer edge, I think. And then you've got the outer bevel, which... No, emboss takes the average, so it does the inner and the outer. Outer just does the outer, and inner just uses the inner, and I usually use the inner. It gives me the most control in what I'm doing. Now, what can be a big difference is the technique. You can go with chisel soft, you can go with smooth, which makes everything look a little bit softer. Also a little bit plasticky and muddy, but I think we can remove that if we go to make the size 1 pixel. You can go to chisel hard, which makes the edges really steep and harsh. So I think only the colors that are truly black, or sorry, truly white, whereas a lot of paint will really pop up, and the others will be pop up much less. So you can get these little crumbs on top, which might be cool for a certain effect, but not to my taste. And then you've got chisel soft, which is something in between smooth and chisel hard. And chisel soft is what I like a lot. You can go with the depth, the amount of depth. I feel no amount of depth is enough for what I want, so I always increase it up to 1000%, the maximum. And then if I want things to feel a little less deep, I will just play around with the opacity. I can go here and say opacity 20% and make it look really soft, or go to opacity 100% and make it look really hard. Another thing that you can do is you can increase the size, and the size is something you need to get just right for the size of your mountains. So if you make it 1, it might be a bit too soft and it doesn't look steep enough, or it doesn't look rough enough. And if you, oh, I'm dropping my candy. If you increase it too much, it will look too, almost like computer generated, chiseled, which I don't like. So for your mountains, you want to find your sweet spot. Maybe around 8 or 9 or something like that. Softens up the paint that you made. I don't recommend it, because you just lose the details. And then angle is very interesting. I like angle 45 degrees, so it comes from 45 degrees and a height of 45 degrees. So it's just like your the sun is like 45 degrees up into the sky. You could also go with like change it around. Let's see which one was the height. This is the angle. So 45. And here you can see the difference if you go from 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. And then the sun is super low. The altitude, yeah. So for me, 45, 45 works. The contour you can give some weird effects to. You can choose your own, which will just change the effect of the bevel and emboss. And sometimes it's interesting, usually not. And then you've got your highlight and blending modes. You can put them at black and white, which will make it look a little plasticky, like this. Or you can find a color that you find interesting for your map. And decrease it in a way that you like it. Maybe something like this. Then you've got your contour, in which you, bevels and embosses the edges of your paint, which you could play around with. And you can add a texture from a texture pattern. So here we've got our sponge again, and this way you could have it interact with that, but I don't turn it on. So that's what you can do with bevel and emboss. What I suggest doing is, for example, create one layer for the foothills. Let me show you, like the smooth and soft textures. Something like this, and then make the size pretty small. Maybe something like this. And then add another layer, or in my case, I will copy the layer. Oh, make sure I select the mask. Clear the contents. And then make another layer for the mountains. And change your size in your bevel and emboss in that to make those look a little bit more steep. For example, like this. So you can have multiple layers with multiple different textures to create your the textures for your lens. So that's what you can do with bevel and emboss. Now, for the new thing that I found out, we're going into something really interesting. I don't know a lot about it just yet, but we're going into height map software. So I downloaded this free software called QGIS. I have no idea what most of these buttons do, but I can use it to do exactly what I want to, and that's extract a height map, a really detailed height map, and use it in Photoshop to make brushes off. So where you go is not to this 10 gram page, but you go to a page called viewer.nationalmap.gov/basic. Yeah, so this is the URL, viewer.nationalmap.gov/basic. And when you go there, you can go to a certain place on the map. What was this place where we were talking about yesterday, Dan? I've noticed we were talking about a place where that movie was recorded, where the guy got stuck between the rocks. That was in Utah, I think. What was that area called? Just waiting for the answer. There's a little bit of delay on the map. Was it this area? Let me quickly Google. I think it was 48 hours, no? What was it? The guy stuck with the rocks. twenty-seven hours, yes. Where did he get stuck? Blue John Canyon, that's where we want to go. So that's where we're going to go. We're going to fill it in here and we say go. Boom. There we go. We're going to zoom out a little. And then we're going to draw a box. Let's click this box. We're going to draw it. And then we're going to make sure in data. It took a while to find it out. But I figured out we need this software. We need 3DEP. This 3DEP. So we click that and then we say find products, and it's gonna find some products. It's gonna show me a couple of different areas where this website has height map info from. So when we click thumbnail, it will show where it is, and it will show that this area has height map data. This area has height map data, this and this. And what we're looking for is for one that has interesting elevation data in it. So for me, this one looks very interesting. So this one was the first one, I think, yeah? Yeah. So we're gonna press download on that. And it's gonna download it. It's 300, 400 megabytes. So that's what we're gonna download just right now. Ava Novus says, try Zion's National Park. So let's try that one. I think we have to go back to data sets. We have to go clear. Zion's National Park. Oh. I think I messed it up. Let's refresh. Zion's National Park. Go. This guy. All right. We're gonna drag a box. Make sure we click the elevation data. Drag a box. We can even zoom out a little bit. And we're gonna say find products. And it shows us some products. So let's check the thumbnails if there's any of the ones that we like that maybe has some interesting information. And for me, the one that stands out at the moment, I think, is the top one here. And I'm gonna say download. And then Ross says, try Bryce Canyon. Okay, I'm gonna do that. Let's clear this. I'm gonna go to Bryce Canyon. Utah. Drag my box. Make sure I've got my elevation product selected. Find products. And show me the thumbnail guy. Here. So we want one that looks interesting to the eye. And I think I'm going for the left one. So I'm gonna press download on that. So we've downloaded some of this information. I don't know which one was which one again. So I'm gonna extract this guy. Let's call this one. It doesn't really matter which one is one. Maybe you guys can recognize this. Let's call this two. And let's call this three. where we are going is we're going, let's check the first one. And where we need to go is we need to take the big file. So this guy is the big file. This one is 500 megabytes. We want to take this one and we want to tap to the QGIS software and we're going to drag it in and just watch this super delicious, super nice height map data. Look at this. This is super sweet. This is much more detailed than the height map data from 10gram. So this is absolutely epic. And we want to extract it as an image so we can play around with it in Photoshop. So what we're going to do is we're going to go to export, export map to image, and we want to draw on canvas because else it's going to show everything that's going to be extracted. And we just want to have the selection extracted like this. And we want to make sure it's big enough. So the way I do it is by putting down 500 dpi, and I'm going to go to save, and then I'm going to go to desktop in my height map folder, call this one, and save. That's the first one that we're going to play around with. Then I'm going to new, discard this one. All right. It's going to crash. Ah, no, it's not. And then we're going to go to, let's get rid of this. Then we're going to go to number two. We're going to take the big file and we're going to, oh, sorry. Not in Photoshop. We want to drag it into QGIS. And then we've got, wow. This stuff is like porn to me. Okay, not really, but it gets me really excited. This stuff makes me super happy. This beautiful. Look at this. Dan, isn't it just super exciting to see stuff like this? I don't know. Am I weird? Maybe. It's a bit of a weird fetish, but I got a fetish. I get excited from height maps. All right, we're gonna export this one. As image, draw on canvas, make this selection, say 500 dpi, and say save, number two. All right, let's go to new and take the third one. We want to take the big file, drag it in. Wow, look at these canyons. Oh, super nice. All right, get them ready to extract. I have no clue how this QGIS program works. I just figured out how to get this thing in. So I've got some people in here. Ross says, I'm watching it on a late lunch. Sorry, Ross. I will keep it safe for work. Right. So there's probably settings that are more optimal, but I just recently figured out this program and what you can do with that. So I probably don't know the tip of the iceberg of this program. So just saying, for now, I'm just super excited about that I found it and I want to share it with you guys. So here's our three files. We're going to start with the first file. We're going to drag it in Photoshop. And we're going to take a look at it just to see what it does. Look at that. Super sweet. Look at that, it's beautiful. We want to make some brushes out of that. I also figured out a way how you can directly import this as a complete height map. And the way you do that is by copying this. Let's make a new layer. Let's make it like greenish. Make a new layer, fill it up with whatever color, and in the blending mode, bevel and emboss. Let's go like this. Make sure we've got a mask in there, make it black. And then we go to channels, and then you can go in here into layer mask. And if you say paste in place, you will actually place the image into the mask. So now we can hide this channel again, and then we can go here. And this is what it looks like, directly imported into the layer. And now we just have to play around with the settings in here. So we can go to very small, we can go to very harsh, which will give a really hard chiseled look on this place. Or we can go to, let's put it at 10 or something like that, or 5. And let's put it as 45. And I'm just not seeing every detail, yeah? So I feel like the image we have here has so much more detail than what we are seeing at the moment. So what we could do is we could copy this guy a couple of times just to get more detail out. Maybe like this. No, I don't like that. So what we might be able to do is use a levels of a curves adjustment on the layer where the information is in, and we can just play around with this just to drag some of this shades up. This looks pretty good. Ross asks, will you add the links? Yeah, I will. If I don't forget, make sure you remind me. If I don't forget, I will add them. But guys, look at this. Oh, this gets me so excited. Look at these details. It's crazy, no? There's little rivers in here, blah, 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 blah. Yeah, this gets me, makes me so happy. See a little bit of banding in here. That's because of the curves, I think. But this detail in this height map is crazy. And you can also say, I want it to go downwards instead of upwards. So now everything goes downwards. You can say, I want to change the modes. Chisel soft, chisel hard. Chisel hard never really works for me though. Somehow. Cool, no? So that's what I found out yesterday. And I already made some brushes with it, but I'm just gonna show you the process of what I do to create brushes out of this information, because it's so much more detailed. What we're gonna do is, Solisium says, you remind me of my computer science teacher. All right, I hope he's a nice guy. Okay. To get cool information for a brush, we want something that has a dark or light edge so we can easily turn it to a brush, so we can kind of isolate it. So to find that, I'm going to add a levels layer, levels adjustment layer, and I'm just going to drag the sliders a little bit. And you already see that we're getting a shape over here. And we want to have the details. We want to have a lot of details, but we also don't want to have we don't want to have too much mess to work with. Yeah, so we want a shape that can be quite easily isolated, and this shape is looking fine to me. What we could do, I haven't done this yet, but we might be able to do it. Let's take a soft round brush and let's paint in with a very low opacity, and we might be able to get some more detail out of this highlighted area. Let's see if this works. No, actually it doesn't. All right. Maybe if we invert. No. All right, no problem. We will use this area. This looks quite pretty. Just create a rough selection like this, paste it, hide all the other stuff. Let's make sure we have a white layer as a background to show what we're doing, and we're going to invert this layer. And now we want to get rid of the hard edges that we might have left. So we take the soft brush, and I am going to remove any hard edges that I can visibly see. Well, I think you visibly see, it's kind of, what do you call it, a penumbrum? You always see visibly. And to make sure that I got all the hard edges, I can turn up another levels adjustment, just like this. And there you can see that I didn't get rid of all the hard edges just yet. Well, I did. I probably did. All right, this looks good enough. So this is gonna be my new brush. Make selection around it. Edit, define, brush, preset. All right, let's go into a playground layer and see what it does. Boom. Let's play around with the settings here, the size. All right. I kind of like the details that I'm seeing right at the top, and I'm not super happy with the super hard edges of the cliff over here, but it might be a cool flat top mountain, or what do you call it, a mesa or something like that. But we can fix that. First thing we need to do is go to our brush properties, make sure shape dynamics pen pressure is on, and add some angle jitter and increase the spacing like this. And now I will just chop with a other color, with black, chop away at the area than I made earlier, like this. And this already looks a lot more pleasing to me. Yeah. So I think this brush turned out pretty interesting. And by just adding and removing paint in a mask, we can create pretty unique mountain formations. Yeah, what do you say? You like it? I like it. So let's make sure we save it. And it's probably gonna be a brush that stays. So just for now, I'm gonna name it Brush Good 1. And I'm gonna save it later and add it to some pack. We can get some more brushes out of the same height map if we go to different areas. So for example, let's clear this. What we could do is just invert the layer to see what happens. Sometimes the eye just gives us something new to look at. And let's play around with our highlights a little bit, our levels, to see if we can get a nice area that we can play around with. So thanks, Michael. Michael says it looks pretty amazing. Thank you. So this shape for me looks quite interesting. It's going to be a bit of a more small brush, but it does look quite interesting. But I'm just showing you that you can get multiple brushes out of the same height map. But for the sake of this tutorial, we are going to go to one of the others, because I know that makes me happy and I know that makes you happy. There you go. Let's go to levels. Just eating from candy. I don't know if it sounds disgusting. What about these guys? One of these guys we can make a brush out of. I'm not super stoked about them. What about this? This might be good, but I can see some banding, so I'm not sure if it's going to be too great, but let's just give it a shot. Oh. I'm not sure if I can do anything with this layer, but this, or with this brush, but this stream is all about experimenting. But you see that we have a pretty harsh edge at the moment, and we want to get rid of that. And one way to get rid of that, I found out, is by going to blending options. And then you can go blend if gray, and I want to blend away the gray. So I can drag this away to this side, and it will blend away until we've got something that's more cut out like this. But it gives this pretty harsh edge. To fix that, you can press Alt on your keyboard and drag and soften it out a little bit by spreading these two arrows. So this already looks better. I'm gonna grab my soft brush. Nope. And I'm gonna get rid of these hard edges. And get rid of this opening of the river. And let's see what we have. We're gonna make a selection. Define brush preset. Yeah! With music. Good. There we go. We're gonna play around a little bit with the size and shape jitter. Let's go with this size. And what I might do with this one, turn on pen pressure, I might put direction on, which means that I could go along an edge of something that I like and just add these canyons in there. But for now we won't. Let's just go to angle jitter. All right, let's go to our playing layer, playing file, and just draw them in. See what it does. So I think it will look even better if we chop away with it instead of add with it. And let's just make sure, yeah, let's, with angle we'll turn on direction. So, no angle jitter. And let's see if we can get like this. And now if we drag around, it will chop away in the direction that we will tell it. And then you get this interesting canyon formation. So this, yeah, I'm pretty happy with this brush. It looks a little bit repetitive around the edge, but it certainly adds a little bit to the mountainous feel. So let's add this. I'm not sure if I'm gonna add this to the set brush, maybe. Let's go back to our height map and see if we can find any other shape that we can use. Or we can just skip this one and go to the last one of the files we exported. Three. This one was with all these epic canyons, yeah. So pretty. I want to see how it looks as a height map as a whole. So let's set it up real quick. So pretty. It's so pretty. Right, let's add some curves on this layer. So nice. What you can also do is, like, if you want to add a certain part of this to your map and not mess around with the brushes, you can just make a selection. Select the inverse, delete, make sure it's black, like this. And then you can just move this whole mountain range to whatever file you want by making it small like this and dragging the layer to your other file. And let's see, where did it put it? It put it right here. And then you can just grab this whole freaking layer and move it to whatever file you're using, which is already very nice. Did I just delete my... Oh no, I didn't. Good. All right, so let's make one more brush just for the sake of it. And then we're gonna go to creating some ornaments in Sketch. Let's add a curve layer. And I think I can already see two or three nice brushes. I'm gonna grab it with a feather, which means that it will cut off a little bit, but a little bit more smooth instead of super harsh. You can see here how it does that, like a soft edge. Then invert this, and we don't need to do much about this. We can basically define a brush preset right away and see how it looks in the playground. Let's add some dynamics to it. Pen pressure, angle jitter. And voila. I love it already. Brush good too. And so we've got 6 people watching. You guys bored or you guys still interested in what I'm doing? Tell me. Let's grab this guy. I'm gonna make a brush out of this one. A little bit of a hard edge here. Let's go to the playground. Now we've got exactly the same thing that we had before. But it doesn't matter. Let's add some properties. Always pen pressure for my pen. Increase the spacing a little bit. Maybe a little bit more. All right, that's a good question, Ross. Ross asks, so it's fun so far. I'm wondering how you would add color to the higher elevations, say a brown or a gray or white for snow. That's something I've been working on. I found a way. I'm not 100% satisfied with it so far, but I've used that way on my current brushes and I will show you how that works. But first, let's create a cool area to make this on. So this brush I'm pretty happy with as well. So I'm gonna save it and it's gonna be brush good 3. To manage your brushes, you can go to the preset manager. You can say make a new group. Oh. Hide map 2. And I'm gonna drag the ones in that were good. And I can select those 3 and say save set. And I'm gonna call it new good. And now whenever I'm in a different Photoshop environment, I can just get these brushes. All right, let me eat a candy and let me grab a drink. And then I will show you how to add a color to the higher tips of the mountains. Okay, so we go into blending options. Sorry for the candy. Blending options. And here you've got a couple of more options. One of them is outer glow. It will add a certain glow around the hills or mountains that you made. I already like what I'm seeing, this greenish color that you can put around the mountain just to give it a slight different color. So let's say this already shows like this is different material than the other stuff. Yeah. You can change around the size. Make it softer or make it harder. The spread. You can add some jitter and noise. Opacity and blending modes. This already looks like, whoa, pretty cool, yeah? This is different texture, a little bit of an inner or outer glow. So now when we take our brush, and we add new mountains, it will automatically add this stuff. So what I like about this is that it works this way. What I explained earlier, let's get rid of this real quick sec, is you can remove your fill opacity. So without the effects, it looks like this. Let's try to make it white. Oh. So now when I draw in, you get this white stuff. Yeah. And normally I have this fill removed, but what happens if I keep on the outer glow and this guy? Look at that. It gives the idea of having some mountains with snow tips. You can mess around with it a little bit, like change the outer glow, make the size maybe a bit bigger or whatever. But let's say I want a bit more control of where the snow will be. I could add a more of a brownish tone for my layer color. Let me show you what happens then. Maybe a bit lighter. Brown grayish. Something like this. Yeah. And then we want to add a few specks of where the snow will be. So we go to blending options, and as Whoa, it's Tiger, says in the chat. Inner glow with center selected is great for that. Exactly. Exactly. So we're going to turn this to white. Inner glow with center selected. And we can play around with the size of this snow. Make it smaller, make it bigger. Fix the opacity like this. Let's make sure we put it on normal like this and not color dodge. And you know what's fun about the stream? I'm actually learning new stuff as well. So this softens it out too much. Let's see. I'm not exactly sure what is this. So range. Yeah, so increase the range of it. So this could be our mountain layer. And I'm quite happy with it. What do you guys think? This looks awesome, no? So let's save this. And let's try with a different brush that we made. So to see how this works, we can also grab a hard round brush. And I can show you what it does. It's basically the edges are dark. The middle is the base color of the layer, and the tip is the white, the snow. If we use one of the other brushes that we made, let's say brush good. Let's increase the size a little bit. We can add it like this. And what's super cool is if you keep adding, the color will become more dark and add more snow. And then we can cut out a little bit like this. Michael says, I have one question. What's your question? He says, T-Series or PewDiePie? Well, I like this. I like PewDiePie. It makes me laugh. So this is this weird river one that we made. Check this guy. All different style of. And you can see that I like this Wagner. And you know, the thing is, I'm messing around too much now. I'm worrying too much. So I'm like, I'm keep clicking to see if I can get snow. But what I forget is I can just copy the whole layer or make a new layer with a new texture and change our settings for it. So our inner glow, I will change our range a little bit. So it will grab the snow on the higher parts a bit more easy. Like this, for example. That's nice of making, playing around with all these layers. Yeah. But I'm super happy with this brush that I made. This brush was brush 3, I think. Yeah, look at that. Super cool mountains. Wood. So, I've noticed, as could you do a subtraction going brown or blue? Yeah, let's try it. So, let's create a bit more randomness here. Look at that. Oh, this brush makes me so happy. This is going to be my new favorite brush. So, subtraction. So we're just going to copy all these layer settings. We're going to clear the layer. And let's find a blue color. Let's go with something like this. Fill it up. And what happens now is they kind of look the same, but instead of the middle color being brown, the middle color is now blue. But what we want to do is we want to make the bevel and emboss go down. And instead of it being snow peaks down there, we want it to be dark blue, I think. Like medium blue, something like this. Maybe. The outer glow. Let me think. We can maybe make. Something like this. Change the highlight mode a little. Maybe something like this, like let's put it below this one and let's draw a little bit to see what happens. Oh. Dan, was this what you were thinking? All right, Michael, nice. Thank you for coming again and see you next time. So Ross says it feels like if you change the height of the bump, you would be pretty close to adding lakes. Yes. All right, let me figure out how to do that. I like the idea. So what we can do is we can select the mountain and make sure we clear that area so it doesn't interfere too much with each other. All right, I'm not too happy with the colors. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna play around with the colors a little. So you say if you change the height of the bump, it can look like lake. So let's change the height of the bump to 1 like this. Rush, you got a pretty good eye for settings because I'm really liking what I'm seeing. So let's see what this does. So inner shadow is not really doing much. Why is that? Because it's the same color as the base of the layer. That's the problem, I think. And the range might be off. There we go. And you know what's cool? You can do maybe color dodge and give it a cool, like a bluish, aquatic bluish hue. Something like this. And let's see if we can do anything with this outer glow, because maybe it's a bit too heavy. Look at this. Alien planet. This makes me happy. So this is kind of lake-like. All that we are missing now to make this a proper map is like a base texture layer. And what I can do for that, just to get it real quick, is render some clouds. Oh, that's fine. And then stylize emboss. Put it on overlay. Yeah, this playground is pretty has become pretty fun. I'm gonna save it for now, and then we're gonna go to the next part of this session. We have about 30 minutes left, and this part is about making ornaments. So we played a lot with blending modes and brushes here, and I think we've really learned a lot. I found this beautiful new brush. which I'm super, super happy with. And I love the effect with the inner glow that I haven't used that too much. Thank you for Woe Tiger for that. That's super. Next part of this tutorial is gonna be about making a cool ornament, such as a compass rose for the map. So let's go to 3000 by 3000 on 300 DPI. And I wanna show you that I didn't know Photoshop has this function. So I usually used Autodesk Sketch for this function. In Photoshop, it's super difficult to get perfect circles and things like that with pen pressure. Yeah, so you could go to the elliptical marquee tool, select stroke, foreground color. Oh no, this is fill. I want a stroke. Let's say 5 pixels. And then you get your perfectly round circle, but it doesn't look too natural because you don't have that difference in line thickness that I love so much when painting. It just gives the feeling that someone made this with their hands and not just with the computer. So to make a circle with pen pressure on is very difficult in Photoshop, and I don't like that. The other thing that I don't like about making this ornament in Photoshop is that I never could find a symmetry tool. But luckily, they've added it. I've recently found it, which makes me happy. It is in Preferences, Technology Previews, Enable Paint Symmetry. Enable Paint Symmetry. This was hiding in the preferences all along. But I've got you, I found you. And with this, you can say, I want to paint symmetrical. I want to have a dual axis and I want to draw in there. And now I'm gonna create super nice symmetrical compass rose styles. But Photoshop isn't perfect for this. I found another program that's much better for this, and it's free. It's called Autodesk Sketch, and to be able to use it, you need to make an account. The account is free, and once you have the account, you can use it without any problem. So you can also export it to Photoshop, which is nice. So why do I like this so much? Yeah, Wild Tigers, what a ridiculous obscure place to put that setting. Yeah, I agree. But I'm glad they're working on it. It's not nowhere near perfect, but I'm glad they are. The nice thing about Autodesk Sketch is you have this thing called the ellipse tool, where you could just make sort of a ruler for your ellipse. And then when you want to draw in, you can actually draw in circles with pen pressure, which makes me super happy. And you can change the ruler to make super quick things like this, and like this, and like this. So making ornaments like that is much easier. And besides the circle, you have the symmetry tool, which is much better than Photoshop symmetry tool. You can say, I want it to go symmetry mirror 8 times. So now when I draw here, it will automatically draw on the other places. But that's not it. There's even more. You've got a ruler tool, which does a similar thing as the elliptical tool, but it does it. Oh, no, no, I'm messing up. All right, let's go like this. So keep in mind the angle, 78. You got the pen pressure going on like this, whoop. And then minus 78 we want to find, yep, to get a similar angle, whoop. Now you've got that copied, super nice. So for making the line art of this Tingy wingies. These compass roses. Oh. I don't know the shortcuts for this program too well. Not as good as I know Photoshop's. And let's turn off this ruler and let's put this smoothing tool on. So to make things like compass roses, this program is so much easier. And you can save it as a Photoshop file. So now, after I've made this line art, I can go somewhere, ornaments, and open the file that I made in Sketchbook and continue working on it here. So for the line art, I really, really like to use SketchUp just because it has so much more control over the symmetry and stuff like that. Another program that you could use is Illustrator, but that's a whole different way of working. That's with vectors. It gives me a little less feel that you're drawing and a little bit more that you're designing. And I use it too much in graphic design school, so I say no, we're not gonna do that. All right, we're gonna make a cool compass rose. On my second screen, I've got a bunch of references, so keep in mind that I never draw this stuff straight from my head. I make combination of cool stuff that I see on the interwebs on my other screen, so nobody knows that I'm actually not that creative and a lot of times just stealing and combining shit. And we're gonna try and find a compass rose that has a style that I wanna emulate. This looks kind of cool. Let's go with this. All right, let's go and put on our circle tool. Oh, double click here to make it round again. And we're gonna make a nice circle. Oh. And then we're gonna make a new layer. And turn this guy all the way down. Ross, yeah. I've studied graphic design and I've had used so much Illustrator that, yeah, it feels, Illustrator is much easier to use with a mouse than, for example, Photoshop and stuff like that. So I love to use my pen, my Wacom pen. So yeah, but Illustrator is a good program. All right, let's turn on the symmetry and let's make one. Let's see, this guy got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 8 times. Maybe we can turn it a little bit as such. Oh no, that's not what I meant. It's okay. Let's just make some lines over here. Make a new layer. Turn off this guy, turn on this guy. And then we're gonna turn on some smoothing. What's this one then? Predictive stroke. What? What? Predictive stroke. Oh, that's cool. Steady stroke, okay, and a predictive stroke. So if I write, F U. Huh, no, it doesn't predict it. Okay, Russ, thank you. Thank you for coming. And yeah, if you like to see more of this stuff, my friend Avant Novis makes a lot of cool maps too. And we have a cool community on Facebook. It's called the Avant Novis Community. Let me see if I can find it real quick. Not to show you my private life too much. Oh, that's my friend. Alright, Avant Novis Community, this thing. Join in, we will post when we're going to stream. And we'll talk about map making, so... This is the map that Dan made recently. So, cool. Join that. All right, back to sketchbook. So we're gonna make more compass and I want more music. Go, go, go. Let's see. The reference that I'm using is sort of like this fleur de lis, the French flower. But I don't want to use the exact same thing. I want to use something different. So yeah, we're in a new layer. So let's sketch something to see if we can get a shape that we like. So let's go here. All right. The problem is, I'm not able to zoom. Oh yeah, I am without. Good. I was afraid I wasn't able to zoom without changing the area of the symmetry. Hey, we've got Discord now, cool. Why isn't it? It's not perfectly in the center. That's a problem. All right, guys. Sorry, I need to learn this program better. Delete. I'm better in Photoshop. Okay. This one can go. I want to make sure that I'm in the center with my rulers and such. Oh. Go away, layer. We don't want you here. Get out of here. Yeah. All right. There we go. Smaller version. Oh, no. Smaller version, new layer. Let's add the symmetry, and this is the problem. The symmetry needs to be in the exact center of these circles. Let's see, circle can go off. So, is there a way to find this exact center of this circle? Hmm. There must be, come on. Let's do it this way. We're gonna use this circle thingy wingy. Like this. Or not like this, like this. And then we're gonna move our symmetry tool to this dot. Let's see. This is working now. This guy moves. Yeah, this elliptical tool, the problem with it, it moves when you scale the layer. That's a problem. That's the issue. So what we can do to fix that is once we found the center, just temporarily place a dot. As such, oh, turn this guy off. No, don't move. Did it move? Did you move? You moved. You moved, didn't you? Screw you, man. Why did you do that? There must be a way to lock this guy also. I'm quite sure there is. All right, so we move this guy. Turn this one off, and there must be here, lock it. Don't move again. Don't you move again. So now we're correct. So let's just make this dot here temporarily. So this guy is stuck. We've locked it. It can't move anymore. So we don't have that problem. I need more music. And now we want to add some of these compass pointers. So let's place this guy over here and this guy over here. There we go. And it is at -73, so we're going to 73 angle like this. There we go. And then we're going to erase. It's erasing my fingers. Why is it erasing this? Oh, it's because I'm on the ruler. Okay. There we go. That's better. And let's go here. Clean up the circle. Alright, so what we can do is instead of 8 times division, we can go to 4 times division. And then I want to see, can I move this guy like this? So now they're overlapping. One thing I need to figure out is how to reset the angle when I turn it around. So let's see. hotkeys. Tools, blah, 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 blah. Phew, I need to figure out how can I fit the view. I need to zoom, move, rotate canvas. I need to figure out how I can put the canvas back to the original position. So you can 9 or 0, control 0. Oh, so 9 and 0 will turn. Control 0, yeah, alright, control 0. I'm gonna change it to the same key as in Photoshop, just because I'm used to it. It won't allow me. Alright. Okay. Keep your secrets then. Next thing that I'm gonna do is I kind of like this whole thing, but I think I made a small mistake. I want to, oh, we can fix it later. I want the full ones to be at the top and at the bottom. All right. So what we can do is we can make this one a bit more fancy. Let's turn predictive stroke on. I feel that this program is much more sensitive to my fingers touching. Oh, we can even change the level. My fingers touching the screen than Photoshop is. So that's kind of pretty. I like that. Let's add some decorations here. We can turn it back to 8 times. Just getting my stroke precisely right. That looks nice. Maybe a little bit of a thingy here. So we're getting there with this thing. I don't think there's something like layer masks in SketchUp, is there? What's this thing? Clear the layer, I think. I don't want it. I don't think there's something like layer mess, is there? Hide, look layer, merge with blue. Okay, there isn't. Okay, no problem. Then we just have to erase in this layer. We can go back to 8. And just erase within here. Clear this up a little bit. Oh, do that in the other layer. We're getting there. Here. Oh, we're reconnected. This is the first time I have it. Are you guys still here? Yeah, I think you are. Good. I think my internet is playing up. Or it's just Pinterest, that could be as well. All right, no problems. Let's go a little bit further. So we add the symmetry. We can go maybe 4 times. And then we can play around in this one. We could even maybe make another ellipse. This is not centered. All right. And it doesn't have to be perfect. It's allowed to be a bit, have a little bit of a hand-drawn feel. So there's also this cool shapes that you can play around with, which are pretty cool. No, I don't like that the tools don't stay at the same place when you move the canvas. The symmetry tool does, but the things like the ellipse and this guy, they don't. So it's starting to look okay. Maybe we can play around with this guy a little bit. Clean it up. Yeah, the symmetry isn't perfectly centered, but it's good enough. All right. Let's zoom in. And I just want to edit the top one now. So we're gonna put this one on. This one can go unlocked. And this one can go here. I just want to make the top one a little bit more ornate. I liked it at the start, but I don't want it too evil looking. Not too much hooks. This looks okay. Let's go back to this guy. Let's hope it sticks at the same area. It did. That's good. What does this mean? All right. 8. Let's send this guy off. All right, let's turn. I did a mistake. This guy on, yes, and lock it. All right, there we go. Lock it. Visibility. On. Okay, this should work. I don't like the center part. So yeah, guys, what do you think? This is more drawing than experimenting in Photoshop, and I really enjoy both. For me, there's I like my maps to have some ornaments to it. So for me, it's an important part of map making. Just something different. Well, this looks okay. Almost like it's like Gears. It's like steampunk something. I just wished, I like what I'm doing at the moment, but I just wish that my my center would be the dead center. But I somehow managed to mess it up. So I kind of like what's happening. Let's make sure we save. We're getting some ornaments in here. Maybe we can go here and make some cool pirate skull. Or is it too cheesy? I don't know. Yeah, why not? Why not? We keep it. Let's see, we might add some. Elements here. Let's make sure. No, yeah, no, maybe. Maybe, yes, no, maybe. Okay. New layer. And I want some detail in these guys. So let's go to 4. I want to mirror it 4 times. Come on. Can't change it because it's locked. Set it. No. Oh, because I'm in here. Okay. Alright. I want some detail in these points, in these arrows. So let's just add a little bit of random stripes. What am I doing? I have no idea. Just trying to make something that looks nice for my compass rose. Just some facets to give it some detail. Pretty happy so far. All right. For now, this will be enough. Let's save it and go to Photoshop and open it up. So this one can be closed. Open recent compass rose. There we go. Merge these guys. Oh, what happened? A white layer underneath. Merge these guys. And the first thing we're gonna do is polish up the errors in the alignment that I had here. So I'm gonna grab this guy, turn on some smoothing, just fix these little errors. Get a hard eraser. But that's why I like SketchUp for the line art and the incredible control in the rulers and such. And it's free. It's crazy. All right. Looks good. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna make a selection, increase the selection by expanding it by 2 pixels, make a group and a layer mask, invert the layer mask, add a layer, call this layer line art, lock it down, and fill this layer with a shade of gray. There we go. And next up, we're gonna just draw in some values in the different parts of the compass rose. So I'm gonna go a little darker in the faceted area. Let's go with the polygonal lasso. And fill it with the foreground color. There we go. Do this for this one as well. It's been exactly 2 hours, my stream says, so it's time to round it off soon. what I'm doing is I'm just filling these different areas with different shades, and because I've got the selections placed, I can easily go in there and change the colors around later if I wanted to. And because I'm below this layer, I can easily take these guys and color them. It's basically filling in a puzzle. As such. And so and so. And then after that, I would shade the thing with some shadows and highlights. And then it would be ready to place on my maps. Change the highlight a little bit. Oh. So I'm just isolating all those different areas so I can start messing with them a little bit better. And I'll quickly show what would happen. Like, if I would have this, I would make a new layer out of it. I would probably add a sort of cloud to give it some texture. Render clouds, filter emboss, like that. Make it a clipping mask and put it on multiply. Overlay, something like that. Copy merged and go to my map. Place it somewhere on top. I'm kind of rushing it right now because I don't want to keep you guys any longer. Just showing you, and then maybe multiply and play around with the levels a little bit, because I want the edges to be clearly visible. Something like this. And that's a pretty cool compass rose for a simple map. I will save this guy, compass rose. I will probably work on my compass rose in between streams for the next time. But this is how I make my my ornaments. I use SketchUp. Guys, thank you very much for watching. Dan, when is your next stream? Do you remember? Is it Monday or is it? Are you doing another stream Friday or something? While we wait for Dan, I will show you a couple of cool things. So make sure you go to this Oven Novice community if you like map making. Oven Novice is a cool map maker, and he created this community where map makers can come together. So you can go to Oven Novice community, join us. So tomorrow, Friday, there will be another stream, not from me, but from Oven Novice, the man himself. Well, let me show you where you can find him, so make sure you follow him. He's using a program called ArtRage, which is really cool. Novice, so you type in Oven Novice, this person. So subscribe to him and ring the bell. So the next time he's gonna do the map making, it's gonna be tomorrow, 12 PST, Pacific Central Time. And if you like what I'm doing, or you want to get some of the brushes or some of the other stuff, I've got a Patreon recently set up where you can download some of my brushes if you become my patron for like $1 a month. You can also do a one-time patronage and desubscribe right away and still get all the stuff. But of course, I'd love to get your support over a longer time. You can do that here. Guys, if you want to see me next time I'm going to be Tuesday at the same time. So that is GMT plus one at 9 o'clock. Or I think it's 1 o'clock Pacific Central Time. But the best thing to do is you can ring my bell on my YouTube. Just below, next to my subscribe button. And then you can see when I'm online the next time. Guys, thank you very much. And yeah. Bye bye. It was a nice stream. See you.